This film is about the sun and clouds and warm waters of the Pacific. We're in the central Pacific, almost on the equator, on remote Manus Island in Papua New Guinea, and on the island of Nauru. The work these Pacific Islanders are doing will hopefully provide us with a better and improved understanding of how the global climate will change in the future. Extreme weather events cause destruction around the world every year. Billions of dollars are spent fixing up after cyclones, flooding, and droughts. Scientists agree that the world's climate is slowly changing, but nobody knows how much or how fast the climate will change. The United States government, through the Department of Energy, is trying to find out.
The ARM program is part of the United States contribution to the World Climate Research Program. It's a Department of Energy program, and the focus of the program is to ultimately improve models that are used for climate prediction. To do that, we need a data set that is representative of the Earth. The tropics represent a very large percentage of the total Earth's surface, and so this particular area, including the tropical warm pool, is particularly important.
American scientists are working together with the governments of Papua New Guinea and Nauru on a sophisticated research project called the Atmospheric Radiation Measurement, or ARM, program. They study the clouds and what happens to the energy that comes to us from the sun.
The ARM program originally set out to do five sites around the planet to try to capture different climatic regimes and different cloud regimes. The tropical Western Pacific was selected because the sea surface temperatures in this region are the warmest they are anywhere in the planet. And this produces a lot of energy and water vapor to the atmosphere, which results in huge cloud systems. And so we're here to study those clouds and also to study the interaction of this with the climate and the rest of the planet.
Most of us would just call it sunshine, but scientists call it solar radiation. It is energy given off by the sun, which comes to us in the form of light and heat. Some solar radiation never reaches the Earth. Clouds high in the atmosphere act like a reflector, and some of the radiation is sent back out into space. A small portion of solar radiation is reflected away from Earth by the atmosphere itself. And part of the energy coming from the sun is absorbed by clouds and by the atmosphere. This means the energy is heating up the air and the clouds themselves. Just over half of the solar radiation reaches the Earth's surface. Most of this radiation, or energy, is absorbed at the surface.
We're basically talking about solar radiation, what comes from the sun to the Earth, and the re-radiation of heat from the Earth back up into the atmosphere and ultimately lost to space. And it is this radiation transfer that is ultimately important to the energy balance of the atmosphere.
The ground and the sea surface warm up with absorption of solar radiation. The shimmering near the surface is caused by air being heated by the hot ground. The hot surface gives off energy. This is called terrestrial radiation. Some of that heat escapes through the atmosphere and into space. This helps cool down the Earth's surface and the air we live in. Terrestrial radiation continues round the clock. Even in the middle of the night, heat energy is given off by the surface of the planet. These images were shot around midnight in Nauru as an aircraft was landing. The flickering seen in the runway lights and the reflection of the plane's lights on the runway indicates that the surface is still warmer than the air and that energy is being lost into space. So, how much of this heat will escape into space? This depends to a high degree on the clouds. On a cloudy night, it is often warmer because terrestrial radiation is reflected back to Earth. On the other hand, if there are no clouds, the terrestrial radiation can escape into space and the night will be cool. It's just like putting on an extra blanket during a cool night. More blankets and our body loses less heat and keeps warmer. More clouds in the sky and less heat can escape into space.
The goal of the ARM program is to try to determine the effects of clouds on the radiation balance of the Earth, and that will be used in these large computer models that are used to predict global climate change. One of the toughest things to predict is the role of clouds and water vapor in the atmosphere on the incoming solar radiation and the outgoing terrestrial radiation. And so our stations are to collect long-term data on which the modelers can use to compare their models to actual data that's taken on the effects of clouds and water vapor on the energy budget of the Earth.
The warm water of the Central Pacific is called the warm pool, or the firebox of the climate system by climate scientists. Satellite images clearly show this area of warm water. The orange color indicates where the warmest water is. The warmer the water, the more evaporation from the ocean surface, the more clouds.
This area has, on average, the warmest sea surface temperatures on the globe. And it's been likened to what's called a boiling pot, or we call it the warm pool region. And it's like a giant heat engine. It's a driver of global climate.
The scientists have found that the warm pool in the Central Pacific affects climate conditions worldwide. They have discovered that the El Nino effect begins here, when the hot surface water moves further east than normal. The last El Nino in 1998 caused problems worldwide. In the Pacific, El Nino often means we have more cyclones. It causes drought and flooding and affects the fishing grounds around our islands. Manus Island in Papua New Guinea is situated about 220 kilometers south of the equator, far away from the mainland. The atmospheric radiation and cloud station is located next to Momoti Airport and operated locally by Papua New Guinea's National Weather Service. The site is made up of a number of instruments and computer vans controlling and monitoring a whole range of sophisticated field instruments. Mary John is an observer with Papua New Guinea's National Weather Service, currently working at the ARM site in Manus.
This one is the dry bulb thermometer. This one is the wet bulb thermometer.
Checking the traditional meteorological instruments is only a small part of the job here. Meteorological balloons are sent up twice a day. They provide information about winds, temperatures, and humidity up to almost 30 kilometers above the surface. A small sensor measures temperature, humidity, and pressure. A radio transmitter sends a signal back to the site where the data is recorded and stored. The sonde also transmits its exact position back to the site. The data are not only used by ARM scientists for climate research, upper air observations are also critical for safety of airlines traveling in the Pacific region.
It's been almost 6 minutes now then that the balloon has been released, and at whatever level it is at the moment, that is the pressure it is showing. And that's the temperature, and this is the relative humidity. That's what it senses and transmits back and is recorded here. So I just leave these and go on with doing whatever I do usually, and then check it every now and then until the flight is over. The balloon bursts, that's when the flight is over.